Hi everyone, and welcome to another Roofing Contractor Walls and Ceilings Legal Insights video. I'm Roofing Contractor Editor-in-Chief Art Eisner, and I'm glad to be joined today by Trent Cotney of Adams & Reese. Trent, as always, I'm glad you're here to walk us through some of the biggest issues facing the roofing and construction industries, legal or otherwise. How are you doing today?
Doing great, Art. Thanks as always for having me.
Absolutely. No problem. Well, lots of news here in the beginning of the year regarding OSHA and what some of their plans are for 2023. We're already starting to see that enforcement, develop. Talk to us about what they recently came forward with as far as their guidance changes for compliance.
Yeah, so it's real interesting. And this is something that I think our listeners need to understand is that OSHA often enacts changes to how its rules are enforced through various memos and, like you said, guidance guidelines. So it's important to check OSHA.gov every once in a while just to kind of see what's out there. So this came out recently, January 26, 2023, and it talked about application of what's known as instance by instance penalty adjustments, right? And what they said is that if you meet certain criteria, and those criteria are if it's a willful, a repeat, or some kind of failure to abate violation, if you fail to report or fail to record something that you were supposed to, or it's related to some kind of fatality or a big event, catastrophe type of thing, then what OSHA can do is they can cite you for every instance of that. So let's say there are multiple employees that were involved, you could potentially get multiple citations for the same exact incident. Okay, so what they're looking to do is basically pile on more citations if you fall within these types of categories. And it's interesting, this isn't necessarily a new rule, but it's a change in how they go about enforcing. And I anticipate that you're going to see these, for lack of a better word, cumulative type citations being piled on, especially in instances where there is, either fatality or the potential of a repeat or willful.
Wow. So it sounds like this is a different interpretation. It's applying it almost like criminal law, that there are many elements and you could face a charge for each and every one, of those. It sounds like this is not good news for contractors or another layer of something you got to worry about.
Yeah, it's definitely not hard. I mean, it's hard enough to defend one, but if you've got, let's say you've got, a 10-person crew, that is involved in a fatality, you could potentially looking at an instance by instance type penalty adjustment based on the number of people that are out there. So it's not only do you have to worry about potential additional citations, but penalty adjustment based on gravity. So I think this is just another sort of trend that we're seeing with, increased enforcement and increased rulemaking that we'll continue to see, I think, at least through the next couple of years.
How soon do you expect the first legal challenge to that new interpretation?
When I first read it, I was thinking about, what would I do? How would I go about defending it? And, historically, when I've had cases where they attempt to cite the same exact set of operative facts, but use different citations, sometimes I argue that they're cumulative in nature and that it's, the safety issue that is looking to be abated is governed by a specific rule, right? So a lot of times where this plays out is in settlement negotiations or at the informal conference where you look to decrease the citation or decrease the penalty amount by reducing sort of this instance by instance application. That's where I think it will come up the most.
Okay, well, more to see on that one. Mm-hmm. And while they've redefined that a little bit, they also separately but related, they also mentioned they're going to increase their civil penalties. Yes. Well, and perhaps that's already underway. What's the story there?
Yeah, so I don't know how many years ago it was, or it was more than five, probably less than 10. They and OSHA announced that every single year they were going to adjust their penalties for inflation. Now, one of the things that we know has happened recently is dramatic inflation increase. So come January, we saw the increase from, serious violations went from 14,502 to roughly 15,600 and something. And then the maximum penalty for willful or repeats went from 145 to 156. So that's significant. I mean, think about this, Art. If you're, let's say you're on a roof, right? And you get cited for a B13 violation, residential fall protection, steep slope type violation. You could be doing the same exact work 4 years later and potentially face a repeat. Okay. And that repeat amount could potentially be the $156,000, which is a lot. It's a lot of money. And I think it's, as we see these fines increase every single year, it's becoming more of a punishment than it is a true representation of what it should be, which is hopefully a deterrent. Right. And I think there's a deterrent aspect of it, but it's becoming, it's punitive in nature. And I think it kind of goes beyond what the original design was in creating these fines. Right. So interesting, as it continues to escalate, at some point, you just got to say, hey, what are we going to do here?
Right. And there are some, I guess I could argue this is a way of, you're never going to make roofing 100% safe or without risk. But this is a way to really kind of drive home the importance of safety, which you often do, mm-hmm. Regularly.
Not only safety, Art, but also, risk mitigation and knowing your rights during an OSHA inspection. That's the difference. It's keeping a calm, cool, collected head. Always tell the truth, always cooperate, but know your rights. That's the key, because it can be the difference between getting one of these monster citations and not.
All right, we'll continue to follow that. And since we are approaching March 2nd, is OSHA's deadline for the injury and illness reporting, also known as the Form 300A, I believe. Tell us what contractors need to know. Is there anything different about this year compared to prior?
So 300A is basically the summary log that you've got to electronically submit to OSHA by that March date. And construction falls within and one of those special industries where if you've got 20 or more employees, you've got to be tendering that over. Now, there is some rulemaking in place to include 300s and 301s within that mix. That's still in the process, so you can anticipate that at some point in the future that may be part of it as well. But the key thing is to stay current with the rules, make sure that you're tracking whatever the latest is on OSHA.gov as far as electronic record keeping.
All right. And it doesn't look like there'll be any postponement or any delay in that deadline like we had in years past, right?
No, I don't think it's going to happen this year. I think, come March, you better make sure that you get everything in that you're supposed to. Otherwise, you could be looking at one of those instance-by-instance violations.
All right. Trent, thank you for your insight today and all you do for the roofing and construction industries. Where can people find out more?
Sure. Go to any of my social media accounts. You can just look for me, Trent Cotney, or go to trent.cotney@arlaw.com.
And before you guys head there, while you're still on roofingcontractor.com, be sure to sign up for our new free e-magazine and e-newsletter so you can stay on top of the latest news and information impacting the industry. Stay safe, and we will see you next time.